Okay, the Torah portion for this week is Tissa, and it means when you take. It's found in Exodus chapter 30, verse 11, through chapter 34, verse 35. Haftarah portion is 1 Kings 18, verse 1 through 39. And the Brit Hadashah portion is Matthew 9:35 through Matthew 11:1. And first we'll look at the pictograms and the gematria fairly quickly, and then we'll get into the Torah portion. Now the first letter of Tissa is the letter Kaf. And the letter Kaf, the pictogram is the palm of the hand, they say, or the sole of a foot it can represent. Yeah. And it means, okay, a wing, or to allow, or to cover, or to tame. And it's the number 20. And the number 20 was the age you had to be counted in the census. And we'll be talking about a census right in this Torah portion. The next letter is the letter Yud. And the pictogram of the letter Yud is a hand. And it means what? Closed or closing upon. It means to work or a finished work. And we know that the number 10 represents what? The 10 words of creation, the 10 words at Mount Sinai, the 10 men in the minyan, how Israel tempted God 10 times in the wilderness, how Abraham was tried 10 times, and there's lots and lots of tens in the scripture. And the Yud also happens to just be what? The smallest letter, right? And the letter Yud is the first letter of Yeshua's name. And he's the one that did the finished work on the tree of sacrifice so that everyone's sins could be atoned for, could be forgiven. So first we have the palm of the hand, the sole of the foot, then you have Yeshua, then you come to the letter Tav, and the letter Tav, the pictogram is what? Cross poles represents the tree of sacrifice, a marked cross, ownership to seal, and the last, right? Because the Tav is the last letter of the alphabet. So right now we have the palm of the hand, the sole of the foot. You have Yeshua, and he's going to go to the tree to what? To seal all those that follow him, right? Because what are we sealed by? We're sealed by the Ruach HaKodesh, by the Holy Spirit, right? And the 400 is 40 times 10, and the 40 is testing and trial. And so we know that Yeshua went through the trial. He went to the tree of sacrifice, and he gave his life for the forgiveness of our sins. The letter Shin, or in this case it's used as the letter Sin for Tissa, the pictogram is two teeth, and it looks a lot like the letter Sin. And, okay, point of a rock, devour or consume. And what happened on the tree of sacrifice? Yeshua was what? Taken out of the land of the living, like it says in Isaiah 53. Okay, he died on the tree of sacrifice, so his life was taken from him. And through his life being taken, what happened? 3 days later, he was resurrected, he overcame death, hell, and the grave, and now he's seated at the right hand of the Father, right? And the number 300 is reference to what? Gideon's army, and it represents the faithful remnant. And so everyone that believes in Yeshua is part of that faithful remnant. And the letter Aleph is the number one. K is an ox, a bull, it means gentle. It also refers to the leader. What is first represents Adonai, represents 1,000. represents okay to teach. And so what do we have here? The number one, the Aleph, represents who? Represents Yeshua. And in Colossians chapter 1, verse 15 to 18, it tells us how Yeshua is first. And also in John chapter 1, it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God, and what happened? And nothing that was made without Him, right? And in another part it says, in Him we live and move and have our being. And so this is all about Yeshua. And if you add up the 20 and the 10 for the first word, that adds up to 30. And the age of 30 was how old the priest had to begin his ministry. And it tells us in the Brit Hadashah that Yeshua was about 30 years old when he began his ministry. Okay, the next part here, Tissa, adds up to 701. We know the 7 is completion, and the 1 is Hashem, and the 0 is eternity, and if you add up the digits, it adds up to 8, which is a new beginning. And Yeshua allows everybody to have a new beginning in Him, right? All they have to do is repent of their sin, do teshuvah, right? Become a believer, and they have a new beginning. And if you add them together, what happens? You get 731.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
And what's 731? 7 again, you have completion. The 3 is what? The Father, the Son, and the Spirit. Right. And the 1 is Hashem.
Right.
So now we'll get into the Torah portion. Unless you want to add more to that. And Debbie, we'll go to Exodus chapter 30, and right away we're going to start out with the census.
Okay, how many verses?
We're going to Exodus chapter 30.
Yeah.
And go ahead and read verse 12 through 16.
Okay. When you take the sum of the children of Israel after their number, then shall they give every man a ransom for his soul to Hashem. When you number them, that there be no plague among them when you number them. This they shall give everyone that passes among them that are numbered, half a shekel after the shekel of the sanctuary. A shekel is 20 gerahs. A half shekel shall be the offering of Hashem. Everyone that passes among them that are numbered from 20 years old and above shall give an offering unto Hashem. The rich shall not give more, and the poor shall not give less than half a shekel, when they give an offering unto Hashem, to make an atonement for their souls. And you shall take the atonement money of the children of Israel, and shall appoint it for the service of the tabernacle of the congregation, that it may be a memorial unto the children of Israel before Hashem, to make an atonement for your souls.
Okay. So now what do we see here?
Half shekel.
In this census.
Everybody gives the same amount.
Okay, everybody.
That makes it easy.
Everybody gives the exact same amount. So that tells us, okay, is that everyone is treated equally, right?
Mm-hmm.
Nobody can give more. Nobody can give less. And it's for an atonement for their soul, and every one of them had to give it, right? And that silver was the silver that was used for the silver sockets for the foundation of the tabernacle.
And what does silver represent, Karen?
And the silver represents redemption, right?
Uh-huh. Yep.
In the Hebrew, it says, ki tisa et rosh. So, and it'd be when they lift up the head.
Lifting up the head, right. And so what...
You know the phrase,
What Hashem was doing here, okay, when he's talking about lifting up the head, is he's elevating the whole nation of Israel to a higher spiritual level. Mm-hmm. Okay, so everybody's equal, no matter what their situation is. There's no favorites, nobody's treated any different. Everybody gives a half shekel.
It's just funny that they translated that to when you take a census.
Lift up the head, right. It's one of those things.
Yeah.
But it's to elevate the spiritual condition of the whole nation.
If you lift up your head, you look up towards heaven, so to remember God, I would think.
And they say here, okay, that there were three separate gifts of silver. Two were required, a half shekel each, and the third one was voluntary. Two of them were compulsory. One was to cover the cost of the temple offerings, and the other one was for the silver sockets, like we said, for the foundation of the tabernacle. And the rest of the silver was used for the rest of the vessels and different things that they made for the tabernacle.
Silver wears well, too.
Yeah.
Gold is kind of separate.
So everybody was treated exactly alike. Nobody gave more, nobody gave less.
I like that.
And so nobody would be looked at any differently, right? Nobody could come and say, well, I gave 10 shekels, well, I gave 2 shekels, well, I gave, They were all equal, because what does Hashem say? That we're all, what, created in His image?
In likeness. Yep.
And He's not willing that any should perish. So no matter where the person is at, and no matter what level they're at, they're all just as important to Hashem. Okay. Angela, could you go ahead and read 17 through 21?
Hashem spoke to Moses, saying, "You shall make a copper laver in its base of copper for washing. Place it between the tent of meeting and the altar, and put water there. From it, Aaron and his son shall wash their hands together with their feet. Whenever they come to the tent of meeting, they shall wash with water and not die. Or when they approach the altar to serve, to raise up in smoke a fire offering to Hashem, they shall wash their hands and feet and not die. It shall be for them an eternal decree from him and his offspring for their generations."
Okay. So this is talking about, okay, what does the word say, that we're supposed to be pure and holy before him? The Lord says, what? Be holy, for I am holy.
Mm-hmm.
And it says what? So they won't die. And it's called what? Nediwat Yadayim, which today is what? The ceremonial hand washing replaces it. Pour the water over the hands. Okay, but what is the word? What does it talk about in the Brit Hadashah? It talks about the washing of the water of the word, right? And what does the word do? The Ruach brings the word to our remembrance to convict us of sins, so we do teshuvah and repent and become what? Pure and holy again. Okay, what also says that what after the temple was destroyed, what happened to each man? They became the priest in their own home. And they washed their hands before every meal, right? Just like we do at the Passover Seder. Mm-hmm. There's a part there where there's a ritual hand washing that you lot yadayim. And actually, what do most people do today? Before you eat, what does everybody
do? What does your mother tell you to do? Go wash your hands.
Right. What is every good mom tell her children to do before they eat anything? Go wash your hands, right?
Yeah.
And they say this is where that tradition originated from. What else are we supposed to do? What are we supposed to do with our hands and our feet?
Work and walk
the things Yeshua wants.
We're supposed to walk in the ways of Hashem, right?
Do what He wants.
And our hands are supposed to do His work, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, Leonardo, go ahead and read 22 through 29.
Moreover, Adonai spoke to Moses, saying, Now take for yourself the best spices, 500 shekels of flowing myrrh, half as much sweet cinnamon, 250, also 250 shekels of sweet calamus, 500 of cassia, after the sanctuary shekel, plus a hin of olive oil. You are to make holy an onion oil from it, a fragrant mixture, blended as the work of a perfumer, it will be holy anointing oil. You are to anoint the tent of meeting with it, the ark of the testimony, as well as the table and all its articles. What did you say to read to?
Okay, you read till 29.
Okay. Anoint the tent of meeting with the ark of the testimony, as well as the table and all its articles, the menorah and its articles, the altar of incense, the altar of burnt offering with all its utensils, and the basin along with its stand. You are to consecrate them so that they will be most holy. Whatever touches them will become holy.
So now we're talking about the anointing oil, right? And what's one of the first things we see here?
Well,
Hashem spoke to Moses, now you. So who's supposed to do all of this?
Moses.
Moses is. And they say that Moses was to contribute and mix those that were needed for the anointing oil. And you have all of these different things. It says what? Cinnamon,
myrrh,
cane, cassia,
and olive oil.
And olive oil. And each one of those, what did we say about olive oil last week? In the last Torah portion, it was what? Shemen? Zayit? Zah? Katit, right?
Shemen, Zayit,
Zah? Katit. And we said that the shemen represented what? Hashem's mighty seed, right? And so when we talk about olive oil, okay, olive oil, the oil was what? A symbol of the spirit, right?
Mm, yes.
Symbol of the Ruach HaKodesh. And so that's mixed in with the anointing oil. And so he's anointing everything. And it's to be what? Holy of holies. They say that a hint of olive oil would be just under a gallon, and some say almost 2 gallons, mixed in yeah. with all the spices.
We could Google that.
Now, nobody knows what those sacred weights are today, and nobody has those exact spices that were used back at that time. Okay, and nobody is supposed to make anything like it.
Nope.
And it's supposed to, what it's supposed to separate, because what God is superior to everything else.
Yeah.
And also what, that this is sanctified, made holy and pure for what? For a higher purpose, right? To what? To be used in the worship of Hashem, right?
Mm-hmm.
And not for anything else.
Mm-hmm.
So everything in the tabernacle was dedicated to Hashem. And it wasn't supposed to be used for any other purpose. And they say actually that this anointing oil that Moses mixed was the same anointing oil that was passed all the way down through, because Moses was the only one that was allowed to make it. He made the batch of anointing oil originally.
I think they'd find that somewhere.
And there is they say that that anointing oil is somewhere.
I'm sure it's in Jerusalem somewhere.
Because what will happen is he anoints Aaron and his sons. We'll go on. Debbie, go ahead and read verse 30 through the end of the chapter.
And you shall anoint Aaron and his sons and consecrate them, that they may minister to me in the priest's office. And you shall speak to the children of Israel, saying, this shall be a holy anointing oil unto me throughout your generations. Upon man's flesh it shall not be poured, neither shall ye make any other like it after the composition of it. It is holy, and it shall be holy unto you. Whosoever compounds any like it, or whosoever putteth any of it on a stranger, shall even be cut off from his people.
Okay, go ahead and stop there. We'll stop there. Let's put this up. Okay, so it says here, speak to the children of Israel, this shall remain for me, oil of sacred anointment for your generations.
Right.
So after Moses makes it, and after Moses leaves the scene later on, there's nobody around to make anymore, is there?
Mm-hmm.
And so whatever anointing oil there is to do this anointing has to be from the same anointing oil that Moses mixed all the way back in the beginning.
You think so?
Yep.
That would be an awful lot. It
says, this shall remain for me oil of sacred anointment for your generation. It shall not be smeared on human flesh. You shall not duplicate it. It is holy. It shall remain holy for you. Anyone who shall compound its like or shall put it on an alien will be cut off from among the people.
Mm.
which means nobody else was to make this anointing oil except Moses. Right? That's what it tells us here, doesn't it? It says that the oil is what? It's Hashem's. And the oil is preserved by him, what? To anoint the King Messiah when he comes. Okay, the next verse is prohibit the use of the anointing oil on people other than Kohanim and kings whose anointment is required by the Torah. The oil will remain intact forever so that no other oil need ever be made. So that means somewhere put away there's anointing oil that Moses made that will be used to anoint the King Messiah when he comes back. And tells us here that it was used to what? To anoint the kings of Israel and the Kohanim. And that's the only place that oil is supposed to be used. Okay, Angela?
Yeah.
Go ahead and read verse 34 to 38.
Hashem said to Moses, take for yourself spices. Stocti.
Onyka.
And galbanum. Spices and pure frankincense. They shall all be of equal weight. You shall make it into a spice compound, the handiwork of a perfumer, thoroughly mixed, pure and holy. You shall grind some of it finely and place some of it before the testimonial tablets in the tent of meeting, where I shall designate a time to meet with you. It shall remain holy of holies to you. The incense that you shall make, in its proportion you shall not make for yourselves. It shall remain holy to you for Hashem. Whoever whoever makes it like to smell it shall be cut off from his people.
So again, what does he do? He speaks to Moses. Take for yourself spices. And what? Moses again is going to mix this, right? Mm-hmm. And they say that actually in this incense, you remember when we were talking about the gematria for Kitisa? Mm-hmm. If you add up all of the letters, it adds up to 731. The digits add up to 11. Mm-hmm. And that's how many spices they say are in the incense. That there's 11 ingredients in the incense. And what was it offered?
Is there a list?
It was offered twice a day, in the morning and the evening, on the golden altar.
The incense
in the tabernacle. And the fragrance represents Israel's what?
Prayers.
Responsibility and desire to serve God. It said that galbanum is a very foul aroma from which the sages say that sinners should be included in the community in its prayers because the incense expresses Jewish unity. And what? Nobody else was to make anything like it, right? Whoever makes it like to smell it shall be cut off from among the people. So it's just like the anointing oil. doesn't give us that in the notes here.
And there's frankincense in it. That stuff smells good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Somebody sent me a scratch and sniff Christmas card. So I now use that thing until it couldn't smell like frankincense anymore.
And this mixture, okay, the anointing oil and the incense, has a very, very powerful aroma to it. And we know that incense represents what we said before, represents
prayers,
the prayers of the saints.
Yerushalayim tefillah, the city of prayer.
And nobody else was to make any like it.
It said the whole place smelled like it when they got going with it.
Mm-hmm. Like I said, it has a very powerful, powerful aroma. And we know that nobody could make anything exactly like it because we don't know the exact spices. They have names here, but they all come from different locations and they don't know the exact weights and different things like that. So nobody could exactly duplicate it today. Anyway.
That would still be there, wouldn't it? The tiny little brains of big sense.
It'll still be there.
That place smells so good in the spring.
It'll still be there. And so, it has, well, very powerful. Now, I do know somebody, okay, and he didn't make exactly like the anointing oil.
We know.
But he was making something, not the scriptural anointing oil, but he just mixed a bunch of spices together. And when he mixed the spices together, he said that the aroma was so powerful that the whole neighborhood where he lived could smell it and he could barely enter his house.
We remember him.
The aroma of the anointing oil was so strong. But like it says here, the Lord says nobody's supposed to mix it or make anything like it. And so, not supposed to. So needless to say, what he was making wasn't anything even close. And it was still that powerful. Okay. Leonardo, we'll start on chapter 31. And go ahead and read verse 1 through 5.
Then Adonai spoke to Moses, saying, "See, I have called by name Bezaleel, son of Uri, son of Hur, of the tribe of Judah. And I have filled him with the Spirit of God, with wisdom, understanding, and knowledge in all kinds of craftsmanship, to make ingenious designs, to forge with gold, silver, and bronze, as well as cutting stones for setting and carving wood, to work in all manner of craftsmanship."
Okay, we'll stop there. So, we see a few things in this scripture here about Bezaleel, and his name means in the shadow of God's presence. In the shadow of God's presence. And what they were supernaturally given what? Wisdom and understanding and insight in every kind of craft, right?
Mm-hmm.
And how old was Bezaleel?
Tradition has it he was 13.
Tradition has it that he was 13 years old. And God poured all his wisdom and understanding, insight, and knowledge into Bezaleel. So he's 13 years old, and he's going to be in charge. He's going to be in charge of all the craftsmen that work on all of the things that get put in the tabernacle.
Mm-hmm.
and he has a helper. Okay, Debbie, go ahead and read verse 6 through 11.
And I behold, I've given him Aholiab, the son of Ahisamach, of the tribe of Dan. And in the hearts of all that are wise hearted, I've put wisdom, that they may make all that I command you. The tabernacle of the congregation, and the ark of the testimony, and the mercy seat that's on there, and all the furniture of the tabernacle, and the table and the furniture thereof, and the pure candlestick with all the furniture thereof, and the altar of incense, and the altar of burnt offering with all the furniture thereof, and the laver and the stand, and the cloths of servant, and the holy garments for Aaron the priest, and the garments of his sons, the minister and the priest's office, and the anointing oil, and sweet incense for the holy place, according to all that I have commanded you, they shall do.
They shall do.
A lot of things.
Yep. And so, Etzaliel has a helper, and it tells us what? Betzaliel, master of design in gold, silver, bronze, cutting precious stones, wood carving, and all of the craft with what? With the curtains, the covers of the tabernacle, weaving the curtains, the partition around the tabernacle, the entryway. A lot of things. So, and he had to have skilled craftsmen that worked under him, and Betzaliel's responsibility was to oversee the whole project and to train the men, the workers, and the different crafts needed to make all of the different items for the tabernacle.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So he had, now you have to think about this, you have men that are probably what, 40 or 50 or, you know, 30, you know, older people working what? Under Betzaliel, right? And he's there to oversee all the work that they do just to make sure everything's perfect. Mm-hmm. Okay, now we come to, okay, whose turn is it now? Angela. Now we're talking about the Sabbath. Now verse 12. Through 18. And this is where we find what the Vishamru, which is part of the liturgy that we recite every Shabbat, right? Okay, go ahead, Angela.
How far?
12 to the end of the chapter.
Hashem said to Moses, saying, "Now you, speak to the children of Israel, saying, however, you must observe my Sabbaths, for it is a sign between me and you for your generations, to know that I am Hashem, who makes you holy. You shall observe the Sabbath, for it is holy to you. Its desecrators shall be put to death, for whoever does work on it, that soul shall be cut off from among its people. For 6 days work may be done, and the seventh day is a day of complete rest. It is sacred to Hashem. Whoever does work on the Sabbath day shall be put to death. The children of Israel shall observe the Sabbath to make the Sabbath an eternal covenant for their generations. Between me and the children of Israel, it is a sign forever that in a 6 day period, Hashem made the heaven and the earth. And on the seventh day, he rested and was refreshed. When he finished speaking to him on Mount Sinai, he gave Moses the two tablets of the testimony, stone tablets inscribed by the finger of God.
Okay.
That was the sixth of Sivan. That was the
sixth of Sivan. And so we talk about what Shabbat, and we talk about Shabbat's also in the 10 words, isn't it? And it says this is what? The Sabbath is a sign. And what day is it?
Seventh day.
It's the seventh day. And that's how Hashem set it up, and it's never changed. But we are supposed to worship Hashem every day of the week, 24/7, right? But Shabbat is the seventh day. And according to the way the Hebrew days go, they go from what? From darkness to light. So it goes from sunset Friday to sunset Saturday. That's Shabbat. And it's never changed. And at this point, what? Moses gets what? The two tablets of the testimony inscribed by what?
Finger of God.
God's finger.
Well, it's pink and I.
Yeah, no.
You're setting message, though. Phone's rattling on you.
And so we're supposed to what? Observe all the commandments and do them. We're supposed to Shema, right? Okay. Okay, now we're up to, are we up to Debbie now?
No.
Or Leonardo. Okay. We go to chapter 32. Verse 1 through 10. And now we get to the tough part.
Okay. Now when the people saw that Moses delayed coming down from the mountain, they gathered around Aaron and said to him, "Get up, make us gods who will go before us. As for this Moses, the man that brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we do not know what's become of him." So Aaron said to them, "Break off the golden rings that are in the ears of your wives, your sons, and your daughters, and bring them to me." So all the people broke off the golden rings that were in their ears and brought them to Aaron. He received them from their hand and made a molten calf fashioned with a chiseling tool. Then he said, "This is your God, Israel, which brought you up out of the land of Egypt." When Aaron saw it, he built an altar before it. Then Aaron made a proclamation, saying, "Tomorrow will be a feast to Adonai." They rose up early the next morning, sacrificed burnt offerings, and brought fellowship offerings. The people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to make merry. Then Adonai said to Moses, "Go down, for your people whom you brought up out of the land of Egypt have become debased. They quickly turned aside from the path that I have commanded them. They have made a molten calf, worshipped it, and sacrificed to it, and said, 'This is your God, O Israel, that brought you up out of the land of Egypt.'" Adonai said to Moses, "I have seen this people, and behold, it is a stiff-necked people. Now, therefore, leave me alone, so my wrath may burn hot against them, and so I may consume them and make from you a great nation."
Okay, we'll stop there. Now, most people, they look at this and they think that it was a whole big group of people that did this. But actually it wasn't. And what do we know about the children of Israel? That even if only one person in the camp is in sin, what does it do?
They're all the same.
They're all punished, yeah.
We know what happened one time when they went out to battle. Somebody hid some stuff in their tent, and some of their soldiers died in the battle, and they were losing, right?
Mm-hmm.
Until the sin was found out and taken care of. And so, and then you have to think about Aaron, okay? Aaron is what? He's the high priest, right?
Mm-hmm.
And what's the penalty for idolatry?
Death.
Okay, but Aaron didn't die, did he? And he was still the high priest, and he served with Moses, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so, there's...
It was somebody else's idea.
And what happened actually here...
It wasn't Aaron's idea.
They say, in the notes here... Okay... Angela, you got your kumash there. Go ahead and read the note.
There were 10 things over there.
On verse, go ahead and read the note on verse 2 and 3.
Aaron knew that they were grievously mistaken, but he calculated that if he defied them, they would kill him. And if they did, that would make their sin and rebellion even worse. Indeed, Hur, whom Moses had assigned to share the leadership with Aaron in his absence, had resisted and been killed. Aaron, therefore, stalled for time. He asked for the gold jewelry of the women and children, and he was certain that they would refuse to surrender it immediately, and by the time the rebels succeeded in seizing the gold, Moses would probably be back, squelching the panic. Aaron miscalculated, for the people were so enamored of the prospect of a new god that they had the gold in hand without delay. This is a classic example of the power of crowd psychology, in which a mob is capable of excesses beyond the imagination of any of its individual members.
Okay, now it says what? And Aaron fashioned it. But they say that Aaron bound up the gold and threw it in the fire, hoping what? That a shapeless mass would come out, which would further delay until Moses came. So Aaron was trying to get out of this. But it says here that there were Egyptian sorcerers that were part of the crowd. Exercising occult powers to cause the calf to come out. They say that Aaron did not fashion the calf, but he is described as its maker because he was the one that threw the gold into the fire.
But think of it, all it was a little bitty calf, not a big old bull of any kind, just a little old calf.
So Aaron was trying to stall for time. Okay, he built the altar and then said, well, we'll have a festival tomorrow, right?
Well, it was one of those unmentionables.
And so basically what Aaron was facing was a rebellion, not the whole people, but I believe it was a bunch of the people that tagged along that came out of Egypt with the rest of them. And also, what did Moses specify? That the festival would be for Hashem, not for the calf.
We use God's special name there.
Mm-hmm.
it was like a one-word prayer. God, so, help us.
Right, verse 5. Aaron saw and built an altar, and Aaron said, a festival for Hashem tomorrow, hoping that in the meantime Moses would come back.
Right.
But Moses didn't come back. They got up early the next day, offered the elevation offerings, brought the offerings, and the people sat to eat and drink and revel. And then it says what? And then right away, what does God say? Whoops, he just disowned all these people. He says here, go descend, Moses. Your people that you brought up from the land of Egypt has become corrupt. Have we seen something like that before? When somebody does good,
I don't know.
Yeah. When they do good, they're mine, but when they do bad, they're yours, Moses.
Oh, even next. Yeah. How did we ever
do that? Well, they thought they lost their leader.
Yeah, they thought they lost Moses.
And they probably depended a little too much on him.
Yeah. Because Moses was their leader.
Mm-hmm.
And so
he'd been gone, and they thought he was overdue.
Mm-hmm.
They thought maybe something awful.
They strayed quickly from the way.
Mm-hmm.
And so the Lord says, well, I'm just going to wipe them out. And I'll make you a great nation, Moses. But we know what, according to Scripture, it says that what? Moses was, at that time, the most humble man on the face of the earth, right?
He knew they were God's people.
And so what happened? Moses interceded for the children of Israel. So who's reading next?
Here.
Debbie, okay. Go ahead and read verse 11 through 13.
And Moses prayed to Hashem his God and said, Hashem, why does your anger wax hot against your people that you brought forth out of the land of Egypt with great power, with a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians speak and say, the mischief did he bring them out to slay them in the mountains and to consume them from the face of the earth? Turn from your fierce anger and repent of this evil against your people. Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, your servants, to whom you swear by your own self and said to them, I will multiply your seed as the stars of heaven, and all this land that I've spoken of will I give to your seed, and they shall inherit it forever.
Okay, so
remember your promise, dear God.
Okay, so what did Moses do? Moses brought God's word back to Hashem and said, this is what you promised.
You swore you would do this.
That you were going to do this. So Moses intercedes for the people.
And?
And what happened?
God relents, or he...
Angela, go ahead and read verse 14 through 16.
Hashem reconsidered regarding the evil that he declared he would do to his people. Moses turned and descended from the mountain with the two tablets of the testimony in his hand, tablets inscribed on both their sides. They were inscribed on one side and on the other. The tablets were God's handiwork, and the script was the script of God, engraved on the tablets.
Okay, so now Moses is coming down off the mountain after he's been up there for how long?
40
he's been
days.
On the mountain 40 days and 40 nights in God's presence, right? And he's coming down with the two tablets inscribed on both sides, inscribed by the finger of God. So He's coming down the mountain with what? With the covenant, right?
Yeah.
That the children of Israel were to accept. And what day was this on?
The 17th of Tammuz.
Now, this is the first time he comes down the mountain.
Oh, 6th of Sivan.
Joshua heard the sound of the people and it shouting, and he said to Moses, the sound of battle is in the camp. But what did Moses say? Who are we up to now?
Well, wait a second. He received the Ten Commandments on the 6th of Sivan.
Yep.
And he smashed them when he saw the calf on the 17th of Tammuz. 40 days, because he was up on the mountain 40 days to receive them.
So he says what? Who are we up to?
Leonardo,
go ahead and read verse 18 through 20.
But Moses said, it is not the voice of a shout of victory, nor is it the voice of crying from defeat, but I hear the sound of singing. Then it happened that as soon as Moses came near the camp, he saw the calf and the dancing, and his anger burned hot. So he threw the tablets out of his hand and smashed them at the foot of the mountain. Then he took the calf that they had made, burned it with fire, ground it to powder, scattered it on the surface of the water, and made B'nai Israel drink it.
So now, so we see a picture here, okay? Moses is coming down, what, with the two tablets of the covenant. This was like what, like the ketubah, the wedding contract?
Written by the finger of God.
Written by the finger of God. But what happened? The people in the camp violated the covenant. And so Moses, what, broke the tablets because the covenant was broken.
He was angry, threw something, and broke it.
And so he took the calf and he ground it up into powder and mixed it with water, and the people drank.
Read that second part of 19. Where it says, given the size and weight.
It says, verse 19, it happened as he drew near the camp and saw the calf and the dances, Moses' anger flared up. He threw down the tablets from his hands and shattered them at the foot of the mountain.
Yeah, the second part in the commentary of the Kumash.
Mm-hmm. Says what?
Given the size and weight of the tablets, it was only through a miracle that Moses could carry them. When he came within sight of the sinful revelry, the letters of the tablets floated back to heaven, and the stone without its holiness became unbearably heavy.
Crashed to the ground and broke, right?
Bazillion pieces, probably.
And he ground the what? The calf to fine powder.
Yeah. Got rid of that then.
So.
That was a good thing to get rid of.
I wonder how big it was.
I don't know.
Okay, now the note on verse 20, I'll basically read this. So Moses made them drink. Okay, there was three categories of sinners. Those who were warned by a witness not to serve an idol and did so anyway, well, death penalty by the sword. Those who did so intentionally before witnesses but not warned could be punished by the court, died in a plague. And the punishment of the rest of the people The unfaithfulness of the last group was that of like an adulterous wife. So Moses imposed on them the test that was given to a sotah, the unfaithful wife accused of adultery. He had them drink from the water mixed with the particles of the ground up calf. Only those who worshiped the calf died, like the one who was guilty of adultery. And at this point, he goes on and they go through the tests and they go through the different categories. Okay, I think we're up to Debbie.
Yeah.
And it says, go ahead and read verse 21 to the end of the chapter.
And Moses said to Aaron, what do this people to you if you brought so great a sin on them? And Aaron said, let the anger of my Lord wax hot. You know the people that just set on mischief, for they said to me, make us gods that will go before us. And as for this Moses, the man that brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we don't know what has become of him. And I said to them, whoever has any gold, let him break it off. So they gave it to me. Then I cast it into the fire, and it came out this calf. And when Moses saw that the people were naked, for Aaron had made them naked under their shame among their enemies, and Moses stood in the gate of the camp and said, who's on the Lord's side? Let him come to me. And all the sons of Levi gathered themselves together to him. And he said to them, thus saith Hashem, the God of Israel, put every man his sword by his side and go in and out from gate to gate throughout the camp, and slay every man his brother and every man his companion and every man his neighbor. And the children of Levi did according to the word of Moses. And there fell of the people that day about 3,000 men. But Moses had said, consecrate yourselves today to Hashem, even every man upon his son and upon his brother, that he may bestow upon you a blessing this day. And it came to pass on the morrow that Moses said to the people, you've sinned a great sin, but now I will go up to Hashem. Maybe I can make an atonement for your sin. And Moses returned to Hashem and said, oh, this people have sinned a great sin and have made them gods of gold. Yet now, if you will forgive their sin, and if not, blot me, I pray, to you out of your book that you've written. And Hashem said to Moses, whoever has sinned against me, him will I blot out of my book. Now therefore, now go, lead the people to the place that I have spoken to you of, and behold, my angel shall go before you. Nevertheless, in this day when I visit, I will visit their sin upon them. And Hashem plagued the people because they made the calf that Aaron had made. Oof.
So what happened now?
Discipline, you might say. Judgment.
Okay, we go to here and it says what, 3,000 died? By the sword, right?
That wasn't that many. Of how many were there all together?
And it doesn't say how many died from drinking the water mixed with the gold.
Yeah.
But we do know that there were a couple, what, Jim and Penny Caldwell?
What?
That did the video. They found the real Mount Sinai and the graveyard and all the different things. So.
Well, that 3,000 was just a smaller group among all the 11
millions. And so you're talking a very small number of people out of the whole congregation actually worshiped the calf.
They might have been the ones that cooked up that own stupid idea.
And there was always, I mean, it followed Moses all through the wilderness. There was always a group of rebellious people in the camp that was always, what, coming against Moses, giving him a hard time. Uh, But what happened? Moses overcame all of that, didn't he? And so did the children of Israel. And all of the people that sinned in the wilderness, what happened to them? None of them made it to the land of Canaan, right?
No.
Now here is a place where we see what? That Hashem keeps books, right? Because Moses talks about it right here. He says here in verse 32, "And now if you would but forgive their sin, but if not, erase me now from your book that you have written." And then Hashem says to Moses, "Whoever has sinned against me, I shall erase from my book." So we know that God has books, right?
Mm-hmm.
And books are mentioned in other scriptures. It says what? That all of the Levites gathered around Moses? What about the rest of the people? Moses said, who's on the Lord's side and who showed up? Only the Levites. And so they became what? Hashem's chosen tribe to serve in the temple.
What about that verse that says, perhaps I can win atonement in the face of your sin?
Mm-hmm.
That's what Yeshua did for us.
Right. And so there's a parallel, isn't there? Okay. Moses acted as what? Aaron was the high priest, but Moses was actually the one that interceded with Hashem, right?
Mm-hmm.
And Moses said what? That in the future, what? That there would be a prophet like me that Hashem would raise up. And he said they were supposed to what? To listen to him? Right?
Mm-hmm.
And Yeshua now is our great high priest, right? And he intercedes for all of his people, right? Just like Moses interceded for the children of Israel. So here, Moses is a type of Yeshua, the great high priest, right? Moses go? Well, we go to chapter 33. Who are we up to now?
Back up to Angela? Mount Sinai.
Yep.
Okay, go ahead and read verse 1 through 6.
Hashem spoke to Moses, "Go, ascend from here, you and the people whom you brought up from the land of Egypt, to the land about which I swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, saying, I shall give it to your offspring. I shall send an angel ahead of you, and I shall drive out the Canaanite, the Amorite, the Hittite, the Perizzite, the Hivite, and the Jebusite, to a land that flows with milk and honey. Because I shall not ascend among you, for you are a stiff-necked people, lest I annihilate you on the way." The people heard this bad tiding, and they became grief-stricken, and no one donned his jewelry. Hashem said to Moses, "Say to the children of Israel, you are a stiff-necked people. If I ascend among you, I may annihilate you in an instant. And now remove your jewelry from yourself, and I shall know what I shall do to you." So the children of Israel were stripped of their jewelry from Mount Horeb.
Interesting, no jewelry.
No.
What does jewelry represent?
And that, well, the jewelry was broken off.
I know, but what does it represent?
To make,
you know,
the golden calf. Well, it was, the jewelry was all things that they took from the land of Egypt with them, right?
Right.
And it was what? A gift, actually, that the Lord allowed them to have, right?
Mm-hmm.
And now he took it away from them. Because they, what? Violated his covenant. Well, what they did is they heard what the tiding and became grief-stricken, and no one donned his jewelry.
They were told not to.
And so originally what happened was what? The tent was supposed to be in the midst of the congregation, right? And the presence of the Shekinah was in the middle of the camp, right?
Now it's going to sit outside.
And now Moses is going to take the tent outside the camp. So Hashem's presence isn't dwelling in the midst of the camp anymore. Okay, so Debbie, you just read?
Mm-hmm.
Angela?
I just read.
Okay, you just read, so be Leonardo. Go ahead and read verse 7 through 11.
Now Moses used to take the tent and pitch it outside the camp, far off from the camp, and he called it the tent of meeting. So it happened, everyone who sought Adonai would go out to the tent of meeting, which was outside the camp.
Mm.
Whenever Moses went out to the tent, all of the people would arise and stand, everyone at the door of his own tent, and look after Moses until he had gone into the tent. After Moses entered the tent, the pillar of cloud descended, stood at the door, and he would speak with Moses. When all the people saw the pillar of cloud standing at the entrance of the tent, they all arose up and worshipped. Every man at the entrance of his own tent. So Adonai spoke with Moses face to face as a man speaks with his friend. Then he would return to the camp. But his servant Joshua, the son of Nun, a young man, did not leave the tent.
So we see that what? Joshua stayed in the tent all the time.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
In the presence of Hashem, right?
Mm-hmm.
So at this point, they just had a tent of meeting where Moses met with God.
Uh-huh.
They haven't constructed the tabernacle yet. And they haven't inaugurated everything yet with all of the different things. So we have Moses, they call this Moses' tent. How did the Lord speak to Moses?
Face to face?
Face to face, right? Mm-hmm. Did anybody else talk to him face to face?
No.
No. Okay, Debbie, go ahead and read verse 12 through 17.
And Moses said to Hashem, "See, you say to me, bring up this people, and you would not let me know whom you will send with me. Yet you have said, I know you by name, and you have found grace in my sight. Now therefore I pray you, if I have found grace in your sight, show me now your way that I may know you, that I might find grace in your sight and consider that this nation is your people." And he said, "My presence will go with you, and I will give you rest." And he said unto him, "If your presence go not with us, not with me, carry us not up from here. But wherein shall it be known here that I and your people have found grace in your sight? Is it not in that you go with us? So shall we be separated, I and your people, from all the people that are upon the face of the earth." And Hashem said to Moses, "I will do this thing that you have spoken, for you have found grace in my sight, and I know you by your name."
By name. Okay.
He was saved.
So Moses intercedes again.
Yeah.
And the Lord says he will go with him, right? And with the children of Israel, his presence will be there. Okay, Angela, verse 18 to 23.
He said, "Show me now your glory." He said, "I shall make my goodness pass before you, and I shall call out with the name Hashem before you. I shall show favor when I choose to show favor, and I shall show mercy when I choose to show mercy." He said, "You will not be able to see my face, for no human can see me and live." Hashem said, "Behold, there is a place near me. You may stand on the rock. When my glory passes by, I shall place you in the cleft of the rock. I shall shield you with my hand until I have passed. Then I shall remove my hand, and you will see my back, but my face may not be seen."
Okay, so Moses is given what?
Vision of God.
A vision of God, not a full total, because no man can stand that, right? Because what would happen? Pure holiness.
Well, what was that where you mentioned just a few verses back that he met God face to face?
Mm-hmm. But now he's talking about, show me now your glory.
Mm-hmm.
Everything. Don't do that.
So he only saw what was his face.
God said he would pass all his goodness before Moses.
Oh, by this it says, this simile of his face refers to a complete and unadulterated perception of God.
Mm-hmm.
But we're only human, so we
can't. Everything that he is.
Mm-hmm. Nobody can know totally. But Moses does get the chance to go back up on the mountain again, doesn't he? In chapter 34.
Yeah.
Eduardo, go ahead and we'll start with 34, verse 1 through 4.
Adonai said to Moses, "Carve for yourself two tablets of stone like the first ones, and I will write upon them the words that were on the first tablets, which you broke. Be ready by the by the morning, come up to the Mount Sinai and present yourself to me there on the top of the mountain. No one is to come up with you, and do not let anyone be seen throughout the entire mountain. Even the flocks and herds must not graze in front of that mountain. So he carved two tablets of stone like the first. Then Moses rose up early in the morning, went up onto Mount Sinai as Adonai had commanded him, and took in his hand the two tablets of stone.
So Moses is getting ready to what? Go up the mountain? Mm-hmm. And Hashem is giving the children of Israel what?
Do-over.
Another chance, right? Mm-hmm. Since they broke the first covenant, we have to do everything over again, right?
Yep.
So, and the Lord didn't make the two tablets of stone this time. Moses had to cut them out this mm-hmm. time, right?
I knew how they looked.
Somehow that's probably just not the same, though.
Huh?
It's probably just not the same in this one.
Not the original. Okay, then we go ahead and read verse 5 through 9.
And Hashem descended in a cloud and stood with him there, and proclaimed the name of Hashem. And Hashem passed by before him and proclaimed, Hashem, Hashem God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering, and abundant in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, and that will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children and upon the children's children unto the third and fourth generation. And Moses made haste and bowed his head toward the earth and worshipped. And he said, If now I found grace in your sight, Hashem, let my Lord, I pray thee, go among us. For it is a stiff-necked people, and pardon our iniquity and our sin, and take us for your inheritance.
Go ahead, verse 10.
And he said, Behold, I make a covenant before all the people. I will do marvels. Such have not been done in all the earth, nor in any nation. And all the people among whom you are shall see the work of Hashem. For it is a terrible thing that I will do with you.
Okay, now stop there. Okay, so what does he do in verse 10? He said he's going to seal the covenant. Again, right?
Alright.
Okay. And what does the letter Tav mean in that word Tissa? A mark, a cross, ownership, to seal?
Mm-hmm.
And the Yud is what? A finished work? He's going to make a covenant, he's going to seal it. And how many attributes of God does it show here? What does Hashem mention here? There's
13
attributes of mercy. And in the Gematria, what does the number 13 represent?
Ahava,
God's love, right? It also represents what? Echad, Hashem is one.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's 13 attributes that are mentioned here. And we can go through them. Start out with what? Adonai, the name that denotes mercy. Okay, it's mentioned twice. The second time denotes that even after someone has sinned it, the Lord can accept his repentance. The third mentions Elohim, denoting power. Four, compassionate, the Hebrew word rachum. Adonai eases the punishment of the guilty and does not put his people into extreme temptation. He's compassionate. Gracious, chanun. He's gracious even to the undeserving. Slow to anger. Okay, what? He's patient with everybody, right? Abundant in kindness. He's kind to what? To everybody. Whether what? In other words, the Lord tries to see us in a good way, right? He tries to see the good in people instead of the bad. Truth. He always keeps his word, preserves his kindness for thousands of generations so that what? The deeds of the forefathers get passed down to their children, right? How we talk about the children of Israel being saved in the murder of what? The patriarchs Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Forgiver of iniquity. He forgives sin if the sinner repents. Forgiver of willful sin will be forgiven if the person repents. Forgiver of error, if we commit sin through carelessness. And he cleanses. He totally cleanses us when we repent of our sin.
Beware of what I command you today.
Yep.
Behold, I drive out before you the Amorite, the Canaanite, the Hittite, and the Perizzite, and the Hivite, and the Jebusite. Be vigilant, lest you seal a covenant with the inhabitant of the land to which you come, lest it be a snare among you. Rather, you shall break apart their altars, smash their pillars, and cut down its sacred trees. For you shall not prostrate yourselves to an alien god. For the very name of Hashem is Jealous One. He is a jealous God. Lest you seal a covenant with the inhabitant of the land and stray after their gods, slaughter to their gods, and he invite you and you eat from his slaughter, and you take their daughters for your sons and their daughters stray after their gods and entice your sons to stray after their gods. Did you say through 18?
Yeah.
You shall not make for yourselves molten gods. You shall observe the festival of matzah for a 7-day period. You shall eat matzah as I commanded you at the appointed time in the month of spring. And for in the month of spring, you went forth from Egypt.
Okay, so here it's talking about what? Don't worship any idols. Don't worship any foreign gods. Don't make any idols. Observe the Passover, right? Mm-hmm. And he says what? To destroy all the idols and all the groves where the people worship their foreign gods. Break down the altars to the idols and the false gods. And he says what? That he's the one that will drive the enemy nations out of the land, right? Mm-hmm. So Hashem is going to fight for his people. Okay, we'll notice, go ahead, verse 19 through 26.
Every firstborn of the womb is mine, and from all your cattle you are to sanctify the males, the firstborn of the ox and sheep. A firstborn donkey you are to redeem with a lamb, but if you do not redeem it, then you are to break its neck. You must redeem all your firstborn sons. No one shall appear before me empty-handed. For 6 days you will work, but on the seventh day you will rest. During plowing time and harvest you must rest. You are to observe the feast of Shavuot, which is the first fruits of the wheat harvest, as well as the feast of ingathering at the turn of the year. 3 times during the year all your males are to appear before me, Adonai Elohim, God of Israel. For I am going to cast out the nations before you, then enlarge your territory, so that no one will covet your land when you go up to appear before Adonai your God 3 times in the year.
Okay, so 3 times a year, the children of Israel are to appear before Hashem in Jerusalem. They're the pilgrimage festivals, Passover, which is the barley harvest, Shavuot, which is the wheat harvest, and Sukkot, which is the Feast of Tabernacles.
Yeshua's birthday, too.
And he says that what, if they're obedient and they keep his commandments and they observe the feasts, that they can all go up and celebrate the feast, and he will protect the borders of the land. Also says again, 6 days shall you work, but on the seventh day you shall desist, you shall not work. And that's the Sabbath again. He talks about it again. Okay, Debbie, go ahead and read 25 through 28.
You shall not offer the blood of my sacrifices with leaven, neither shall the sacrifice of the feast of this Passover be left to the morning. The first of the fruits of your land you shall bring to the house of Hashem your God. You shall not boil a kid in his mother's milk. And Hashem said to Moses, write down these words after the tenor of these words. I have made a covenant with you and with Israel. And he was there with Hashem 40 days and 40 nights. He didn't either eat bread nor drink water. And he wrote upon the tables the words of the covenant, the 10 words.
Okay, so here Moses is what, on the mountain 40 days and 40 nights?
All over again.
All over again, and Hashem goes over everything again with Moses, right? And he has the 2 tablets written by the finger of God again to come down the mountain. And he says here what? You shall not slaughter my blood offering while in the possession of leavened food. What did leaven represent?
Sin.
Leaven represented sin. And he says not to leave the Pesach offering overnight. And he says what? The first of the lands, early produce shall bring to the temple of Hashem. That's what, the first fruits? And then he says, do not cook a kid in its mother's milk. And there he's talking about what? Meat and dairy, they say. And basically they're just saying here that verse 26, is that what? That you're doing something that's what? Nardo, Angela, anybody?
What, doing what?
Boiling a kid in its mother's milk.
What, poor little what? Thing, the milk's supposed to be to feed him. Mm-hmm. I cook him, man. Mm-hmm. They said the pagans used to do that.
And they said that was a pagan practice, and that's why they're not supposed to do it. And it's also pretty nasty and mean, isn't it?
Yeah, poor baby cat.
And also, you will find beside that it's command of Hashem, they have figured out that eating meat and dairy together scientifically is not a good thing for us to do.
Doesn't digest well.
Because it doesn't digest right in your system. Okay, how much time do we have left? Okay, we'll just stop here. This Torah portion is all about Yeshua.
Amen.